Hello, and welcome to this video around the Perkins CVI assessment areas, an overview of the CVI visual behaviors. My name is Marguerite Tabato, and I'll be presenting today alongside my colleague, Rachel Bennett. So what is CVI? According to individuals with CVI, families, current research, and educators, CVI is a brain-based visual impairment caused by damage to the visual pathways or visual processing centers of the brain. CVI is the leading cause of blindness in children. Individuals with CVI struggle with visual attention and visual recognition, resulting in a lack of access to and understanding of the world around them. CVI is lifelong, and all manifestations of CVI are a big deal for the individual. It's not up to sighted individuals to make assumptions about the extent to which an individual with CVI is impacted. With CVI, it's important to understand that every individual person's lived experience is different. For example, it's been reported that some see the world as a swirling mass of color and light movement that's incomprehensible and overwhelming. Some can focus at times, but may still struggle to understand what they're actually seeing. Many might shut out the world altogether. They might avoid looking at objects and people, and even their own parents, because it's just too difficult to make sense of their surroundings. Others might appear to have learning difficulties or become anxious in new environments. Some individuals with CVI might use a white cane to navigate safely in their environments and communities. And many experience what's known as CVI meltdowns, and this is due to fatigue brought on by too much competing sensory input. There is a diversity in the presentation of CVI. And when we're thinking about access to information, it's about access to learning. Everybody uses their senses differently and has different strengths. Visual skills are not a prerequisite for learning and access. And with comprehensive and integrated assessment and accessible educational programming, individuals with CVI can learn to access their world in the way that works best for them. Some use visual skills, some use compensatory strategies, and some use both. When considering the CVI visual behaviors, there are 16 areas of assessment that we look at here at Perkins. First, there's visual attention. And next, there's visual recognition. Visual attention is what the child can look at, and visual recognition is what the child can look at and understand. And visual attention and visual recognition are really the focal points around the whole assessment. Every other area of assessment falls under these two categories. Another area of assessment is the impact of clutter and crowding. How much visual information can the child take in at any one given moment? Visual field abilities, where the child can look and understand. Impact of color, what drives visual attention, and how does color impact recognition? Form accessibility, what form does the visual stimuli need to be in order for it to be attended to or recognized? So this can be around three-dimensional or two-dimensional forms. There's visual guidance of the upper limbs, this is hand-eye coordination. Visual guidance of the lower limbs, this is foot-eye coordination. Access to people, which looks at attention to people, facial recognition and implications on social skill development. Impact of light in terms of visual attention, visual recognition, and also the presence of photophobia. Response interval, and this is the amount of time it takes for a child to look at something, recognize it, as well as respond. There's the impact of motion. This looks at how movement drives visual attention or impairs visual attention and recognition. Sensory integration, how much competing stimuli can be tolerated and how does it impact vision? Visual curiosity is around distance viewing and how much incidental information the child can receive in any one given scenario. And then there's appearance of the eyes, as well as the movement of the eyes. And when we're considering all these areas of assessment, we're also looking at compensatory skills. What other strategies is the child using in order to gain information and access to learning? Compensatory skills are tremendously valuable and should be considered across all areas of assessment. And as we move forward with the visual behaviors, we also have to discuss the fact that all these areas of assessment connect to one another. And a CVI visual behavior can never be looked at in isolation. The brain is not linear, and neither is the use of functional vision. Our visual system is a highly integrated neural network. So here's a bit about what the research says. The network level findings point towards the existence of more intricate, context-driven functional networks selective of what and where information, rather than segregated streams of processing along ventral and dorsal brain regions. This sharp dichotomy between ventral and dorsal streams has been progressively smoothened. It seems clear that the fine precision of our visual skills and their importance in action-related mechanisms are reflected in the high complexity of the involved neural architecture. So what do these intricate pathways mean for functional vision assessments? So here's an example that we're going to go through. We're going to look at the category of access to people. And this goes well beyond eye contact and facial recognition. When we're thinking about access to people, we're thinking about the impact of visual attention, clutter, visual guidance of upper limbs, motion, impact of light, impact of color, sensory integration, visual field accessibility, visual curiosity, and response interval. So now let's look at all the considerations that one would have to have when considering access to people. Here's a simulation. It's not meant to capture what an individual with CVI is experiencing, more just as an example of things to consider around the intricacy of the neural networks and observed visual behaviors. So on the screen, I have a photograph of a classroom. On the left-hand side, there's a teacher wearing a yellow sweater, and there's four students positioned around a table in front of her. The teacher is holding up her hand and high-fiving one of her students. If a child with CVI has a visual field loss, their visual accessibility to the scene becomes reduced. So in this photograph, the window of the photograph has become smaller, and you can no longer see the peer in the bottom right-hand corner. A child with CVI might have difficulty with recognizing faces and interpreting facial expressions. They might have difficulty responding to moving gestures, such as a point to relevant materials or a high five, due to impaired motion perception. They might have difficulty with recognizing people at a distance, reducing information that's incidental. Or they might rely on the color of their friends and teacher's shirt in order to locate them. So now in this photograph, the faces of the peers have become blurred, and the high five exchange has become blurred. The child can no longer tell the expressions of their peers, gain information about their emotions, or see social exchanges. A child with CVI might demonstrate some overattention to environmental light to avoid the visual commotion of a scene such as this. So now the photograph has become even more blurred. The child with CVI might look away while being spoken to or put their head down because of all the noise and visual inaccessibility. A child with CVI might place their head down due to the crowding of the peers at the table, the clutter of the background environment, and visual fatigue. And now at this point, the photograph has become very dark and indistinguishable.
Thank you, Marguerite. We're going to go through another scenario that shows how interconnected the CVI visual behaviors are and how much they play off of each other to provide a lot of barriers to access for people with CVI. We're going to focus on the impact of clutter and crowding. Clutter is a huge barrier to access for many individuals with CVI. The world is clutter. And so this assessment area evaluates the student's ability to attend to, recognize, and/or navigate materials or learning environments with varying levels of clutter and crowding. And there are three images here. We have a random pile of toy animal figurines. And then the next to it, there are individual animal figurines placed in a black muffin tin, one individually for each cup, and it provides spacing between each item and a predictable order. So this is much more accessible for visual search for many with CVI. And then in the two pictures on the bottom, we have one with a teacher reading a book with a lot of visual clutter behind her, toys and pictures and just a lot. So she really fades into the cluttered background. And then we have the same teacher, but with a black sheet or curtain that hides that background, that visually cluttered background. So the teacher is able to just to pop out more. And then individual CVA may have less of a more difficult time accessing whatever that teacher is doing. Okay, so let's play out this clutter scenario with an everyday environment like the kitchen. And so we have a counter an island countertop right here in the center. In the background, there is a sink with a dishwasher and a stove. And then we have a bright blue yellow cup with a bright yellow lid and a bright blue straw. So believe it or not, there's already some pieces of clutter that we can point out in this scene. We have light and glare. A person with CVI can be easily distracted by light and glare. The more light, the more visual stimuli. Light counts as clutter. And we see this glare here on the countertop. We have this really busy pattern. This adds to the visual clutter. So this countertop is this deep black and white marble. It's really busy. And we have this really brightly colored cup, right? This might be a really familiar cup for a person with CVI. And color draws attention and supports recognition with and without clutter. So in everyday life, there's most likely many more items on this countertop, right? Many people live in this house. And so maybe there is the person with CVI's iPad near them. Maybe they have a snack plate. Maybe there's a favorite yellow Pop-It toy. Maybe there's another sensory toy near them. And really, these items together are clutter, are crowding for many with CVI, and clutter disturbs form accessibility, making it difficult to recognize any one of these objects. But of course, there's more that can be added. We have a bowl of popcorn, maybe it's a sibling snack. We have some crumbs of old bread and popcorn on the countertop. There's some trash in the middle of the countertop. A sibling might have just come home and put their lunchbox on the countertop near the cup and some Lego figurines. And so the more clutter, the more difficulty with visual recognition, especially when there's a lack of context clues for the added items in the clutter. So we have these, you know, Lego toy figurines might be really out of place on the kitchen counter, are already abstract figurines in themselves, but maybe they belong in the Lego bin in the playroom, and then being here really violates that memory and that perception that so many people with CVI rely on. And also, too much clutter makes visual guidance of the upper limbs to reach for the object difficult or near impossible. It's really difficult in the presence of clutter to use those visual motor skills. And so let's add a few more items to this countertop. We have a paper towel holder, a parent's coffee cup. We have some maybe clean dishes that just came out of the dishwasher, some silverware that needs to be put away, all of this adding to clutter. So the more visual clutter, the more to look at, switch between, and the more to try to ignore, making visual attention difficult or near impossible for many with CVI. Clutter may also reduce visual field abilities, making it difficult to put together and see the whole scene. Some with CVI report that in the presence of clutter, their visual field reduces significantly. They're only able to track one item at a time. And others say that when there's a lot of clutter, it's really hard to control where to look and where not to look. And then we have clutter causing fatigue and increased response interval. So the more visual stimuli means the more the brain needs to ignore and rule out, and the more visual search that's required, which can cause a lot of fatigue, which can then lead to anxiety and stress and frustration and confusion. And then, of course, this isn't a perfectly quiet environment. The kitchen is the heartbeat of any home. And so there are most likely people talking around the person with CVI, right? There might be noises both inside the kitchen, like washing the dishes or a fan going on or plates being put away, or noises outside like a truck backing up or a dog barking. There might be distracting movement of people walking by. The temperature might not be just right. It might be too cold or too hot. Right, and as the person with CVI might be using tactile skills to scan through the clutter and find that cup and find what they want, they might come across those crumbs on the counter and it might be a little jarring and unexpected. And then, of course, clutter increases difficulty with access to people. Who is talking? Where are they? And so the CVI brain is overloaded. And according to some with CVI, when there's too much clutter, which causes fatigue, right? Their vision goes blurry. It becomes just a blurry mush of a scene. And you can see here how important color becomes to be able to track an unrecognizable visual world. Some report that their vision can be like hallucinations or like a fun house, really traumatic and frustrating and confusing. And again, these are two abstract representations. But it's important to understand that clutter can have a huge impact on how an individual with CVI can access the world and perceive the world. And so, with an increased visual load, individuals with CVI have to grind it out, which eventually leads to frustration and anxiety. This perpetuates throughout the day, causing a vicious cycle of fatigue and stress. This is from Dr. Lotfi Mirabet, a leading CVI researcher. And so individuals with CVI have to do what's called serial processing, scrutinizing one piece of information at a time when there is more sensory information to take in. Serial processing is a less efficient form of visual search, as opposed to what's called parallel processing, where one can instantly capture multiple pieces of visual information at a time, right? You can walk out and see the entire environment, the entire scene at once. And so, what might serial processing look like for an individual with CVI? You know how that visual field might reduce in the presence of clutter, and so perhaps it reduces so much that they only are able to look at a small piece of an item at a time, so perhaps the edge of that iPad. And then maybe that yellow pop-it toy. And then maybe that, what is that? That red bowl of popcorn. And then moving on down to that pink plate with some snacks on it. And they may see a little edge of that blue cup with the yellow top. And they're able to finally find that blue cup with the yellow top. And so the world is clutter for individuals with CVI. Dr. Gordon Dutton, a leader in the field, says society chooses to present information in a way that the majority of people can see clearly by ensuring that it falls within these normal limitations. And Matt Teigen at TVI and a leader in the field says our houses, highways, movie theaters, airports, and classrooms, and the tasks that we do in them have been engineered to match the visual abilities of the vast majority of people. And Matt continues to say, individuals with CVI spend their day in a world designed for someone else, in a world that is not accessible and that is not fully inclusive. And this is why holistic, comprehensive assessment is so critical for life-changing access for people with CVI. The CVI visual behaviors all overlap at any given time and situation. We need a holistic and comprehensive assessment that looks at every possible angle to create a baseline of understanding of how CVI and other factors uniquely impact the individual. Ongoing assessment is critical to better understand the impact of the CVI visual behaviors and the interventions that are supporting access to learning. Learn more about what comprehensive assessments look like for individual CVI on CVI Now. And here we have a big running list of our references for all of the CVI visual behaviors. You can go to the CVI Research Library on cvinow.org to find all of the current research related to the brain, CVI, and the visual system. And here at the CVI Center, we believe that every child with CVI is teachable. Of course they are. And every child has a right to a meaningful and accessible education, no matter how CVI manifests or where they live. We are urgently confronting the leading cause of childhood blindness. Join us. Learn more about the CVI Center at perkins.org/CVI and go to cvinow.org to learn all about each of the CVI visual behaviors and much, much more. Thank you.